Dear Epic Games, hi, it's-a me, Austin. I know this is a totally hipster thing to say, but I've actually been playing Fortnite on and off since before it was popular, and I am terrible at it. I am just the worst. That's not really relevant to this video at all, but I thought you should know how atrocious I am at this game. I'm an introvert. I panic. I don't like social interaction, so I drop down at the very edges of the map and spend the entire match hiding from people and inching my way toward the center, getting progressively more anxious until someone finally gets the jump on me and my character dies from a heart attack.
Point was I trying to make?
Oh, right. Before it was popular. Why do I bring that up? Because for almost an entire year, I've been trying to brainstorm a video idea for this game. Is the world's population screwed because 98% of humans were wiped out? Nope. Turns out we'd be just fine, other than being more or less rewound back to cave person days. Viable human populations can number in the tens and harbor enough genetic diversity to avoid major genetic illnesses. Although family trees would be a bit redneck rampagey. Okay, so a rocket creating space-time rifts. That wouldn't happen. Alright, the cube. The cube! Let's do something about the cube! It's a bouncy jello brick. I got nothing. And then I realized, after all that, the answer had been staring me in the face all along. It's been there since the very beginning. It's not a plot-related thing. It's not something you wonder about, but it's something that every single person who's played Fortnite or watched a streamer play Fortnite is familiar with. The Battle Bus. How the hell does this thing work? I can say with 100% conviction that this was absolutely one of the most fun episodes I've worked on in a long time. The math was a joy, and even the problems I ran into by accidentally tacking on an entire extra number to my air pressure calculations that gave my atmosphere a density more resembling aerogel than actually air. Buoyancy mathematics is just fun and easy to understand and explain in a way that, say, typical aerodynamics isn't. All right, so. Buoyancy. How does it work, and can we use it to lift a grade A big old honkin' battle bus into the sky? The answer may surprise you. Buoyancy is everywhere. You have it, in fact, right now. Sitting in your chair watching this video in class or on the toilet, buoyancy is an upward force exerted on any object, like you, that is immersed in any fluid. Not liquid, mind you, fluid. There are a lot of complicated and technical definitions for fluids in science and physics, but the TLDR is that a fluid is any collection of molecules that deforms easily to stresses, so gases, plasma, liquids, these are all fluids. And any object that's submerged in a fluid deforms it, and that fluid pushes back. An object just sitting on the table has, therefore, several forces acting upon it. There's the force of gravity pulling it down, the force of the surface pushing up, and the force of the surrounding gases that are deformed by the object pushing it from all sides. The side forces cancel out, and what you're left with is a single upward force exerted by the fluid. This is buoyancy. The amount of upward force created is dependent upon the mass of the displaced fluid. This is why a ship like the Titanic could float in water, but not in air. Water has a significantly higher density than air, and this is why it sank when it filled with water. It was no longer displacing enough fluid to stay floating. Hot air balloons like the Battle Bus take advantage of this principle by heating up the air inside the envelope. That's the technical term for the balloon. This reduces the mass inside the balloon while increasing its volume. As gases heat up, they expand. So as the battle bus inflates its balloon with heat, some of the air escapes from the bottom as it's pushed out by the decreased real estate for violently flailing molecules. The balloon will also increase in size as the heated up gas pushes outward, displacing more of the fluid. This increases the buoyancy force and decreases the total mass of the system, which can allow it to float. Simple, right? So in order to know if this battle bus can even work, we have to take a few measurements. This thing is almost a component for component remake of the American Blue Bird Vision model of bus, which weighs in at a whopping 14,960 gram nice kilograms, or over 33,000 £1,000!
Yikes!
However, if you were wanting to make a battle bus in real life, you'd be smart and gut absolutely everything you could out of the bus. We can even see by peeking in from the waiting zone that there don't appear to be any seats inside. This is a good start since a standard floor plan of a Bluebird Vision has over 40 seats, with each weighing a conservative 10 pounds, we can actually dump almost 200 kilograms of weight just out the gate. Now we can see from both the starting zone and the crashed battle bus on the island that the engine is still in the bus, which would probably be a Ford 6.8L Triton V10 capable of pushing a respectable 362 horsepower with 620 newton meters of torque at 3,250 revolutions per minute, with a maximum RPM of over 5,000 and a 9.2 to 1 compression ratio, which would weigh over 283 kilos or 600 pounds. This probably means that the transmission has 6R144 torque shift at 147 kilos, and the cooling systems and the alternator are all still inside. And you can see from the crashed bus that the drivetrain, this long piece here that's responsible for distributing power from the transmission to not just the front wheels but also to the back ones, is still in place. What does this matter? Weight. So much weight. If you wanted to build a battle bus in real life, you would just remove all of this. Gut this thing. Transmission, alternator, engine, drivetrain, radiator, electrical systems, everything must go.
Sunday, Sunday, Sunday.
If we remove all the stuff we don't need, we can bring the weight of the bus down from 14,969 kilograms to 13,903. That may seem like a small gain, but that's over a metric ton of weight. That's over 21,000 hot dogs of weight. Zell would lose his freaking mind. Now, wait, before you celebrate this victory of human engineering, you can't forget why we did this. To pack this thing to the gills with people. At first, I was convinced that this would be the most difficult part since there's 100 freaking people crammed into this thing at the start of any given match, but the fact of the matter is that these buses were rated to house 78 passengers in seats, so cramming 22 more folk when it's standing room only isn't that much of a stretch. The problem arises when we factor in how much these people weigh. 100 people weighing, well, let's be generous and say 60 kilograms, since this is a post-apocalypse after all, would add over 6,000 kilos of mass to this thing. Yikes. Glad we took all that weight out now, aren't ya? This gives us a total mass we need to lift of over 19,903 kilograms, 19.9 metric tons, over 43,000 pounds, or 207,323 cans of Fancy Feast Gravy Lovers Beef Fest in roasted beef flavor gravy, hashtag not a sponsor. Now, doing some clever pixel measurements, we can figure out how much buoyancy force this balloon is causing if we can figure out its size. Using some approximations that are overly generous, we can calculate that it has at most an internal volume of just shy of 250 cubic meters of air. And we want to heat this up as much as possible to minimize its mass so the balloon is lifting less weight. If we blast this air until it's a piping hot 225 degrees Celsius, just shy of the melting point of nylon, one of the best materials to make hot air balloons out of, we can cut the internal air density at sea level from 1.225 kilograms per cubic meter and 305 kilograms to 0.71 kilograms per cubic meter, or just 176.4 kilograms. Now we're talking! Now we could reduce the weight even further by using helium, but it'd be hard to heat and contain, as the gas would likely just escape out the hole in the bottom, and hydrogen, well, we've done hydrogen before. Taking all this into account, we have a lifting force of over 2,991 newtons. Awesome! That is a lot. It's got the word thousand in it. Unfortunately, it's garbage. Total trash. It's enough to lift probably, like, one person off the ground in a wicker basket. But nothing close to enough to lift this bus packed with people, plus the air inside the envelope. Even if we magically sucked all the air out of this thing, it would barely increase the buoyancy, and not nearly enough to lift 100 people and a freaking bus. Maybe if you put rockets on the bottom of the bus, you could do it, but even still, this freaking thing barely puts a dent in the 196,899.8 newtons of force needed to lift this thing up in the air. I know what you're thinking.
But Austin, gravity in Fortnite is probably lower than the Earth's. It's a video game. Look how high why you can jump, man!
Oh, you do not want to duel with me on this one, Kemosabe, because you'll get wrecked! Gravity in almost every game out there is way higher than Earth's. People just have awesome glutes that can jump super high. This is because platforming at 9.806 meters per second squared just creates a laborious game feel. And Fortnite is no different. Using the upturned bus as a ruler with a width of 2.438 meters, we can measure the gravity of Fortnite, which clocks in at over 28 meters per second squared, or over 2.8 times the surface gravity of Earth. So, no, doing all the math... doing our math using Earth's gravity is more than being generous. But we're not done yet, not by a long shot. So, fine, this doesn't work. But what would it take to lift this behemoth off the ground? To cancel out all the 196,899.8 newtons of force needed to lift the bus, the air in the balloon, and the people inside, a balloon would have to be 16,526% larger than the one we see in game, which, you know, it's freaking giant. It'd be 37 meters across, almost 20 times larger than modern hot air balloons. Holy crap. That's large enough to hold 46,669,846 big gulps from 7-Eleven. At the current camera zoom, it'd take a 4K monitor tilted 90 degrees on its side in order to show this thing on screen. And then, of course, there's the air pressure at altitude, which decreases the efficiency of hot air balloons as the difference in pressure between the inside and the outside diminishes exponentially with each meter you float up. Using the falling speed of the hang glider, measured again with the width from the overturned bus, which turns out to be 3.18 meters per second or 7.11 miles per hour, we can figure out how high this bus is at start. And with a fall time of over 2 minutes, 44 seconds, and 3 frames to sea level, we can determine that this bus is floating over 520 meters above sea level, where the surrounding air has a density of 1.15 kilograms per cubic meter, and the air density inside our oven in the shape of a hot air balloon is 0.6659 kilograms per cubic meter. And turns out at 37 meters wide, our balloon is almost perfect. In fact, it'd actually be able to float a little higher before it reaches equilibrium, so we could probably drop the temperature inside down a skosh and reduce the risk of accidentally melting our balloon. Honestly, I'm impressed. Most things are completely improbable and unfeasible, but this mostly comes down to a problem with scale and aesthetics. Duh. Turns out sometimes things that appear mostly stupid are actually mostly not stupid. Well done, Epic Games. You made a mostly possible thing. Congratulations! Although, I would respect you infinitely more if you actually made your battle bus look more like this instead of this. Sincerely, Austin. Since you made it here to the end plate, why don't you subscribe to the Game Theorists?
I demand you do it.